Good morning, everyone. Please stand as we begin our Eucharistic service on this, the 18th Sunday after Pentecost. Let us pray. O Lord, our Creator and Redeemer, as you have given us this day for worship, so now we bring to you the service of our hearts and hands and our voices. Accept our prayers and praises. Speak to us through the Bible as we hear it read and taught. Deepen our fellowship one with another. And when we leave your house, may it be with your joy in our hearts. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I chose you and appointed you, says the Lord, that you should go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. We begin with our opening hymn, which I invite you to hum along to, How Great Thou Art. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ. With the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father, Amen. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Almighty God, you have built your church on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. Join us together in unity of spirit by their teaching, that we may become a holy temple, acceptable to you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the first reading from Holy Scripture.
A reading from the book of Exodus, chapter 20, verses 1 to 4, 7 to 9, and 12 to 20. Then God spoke all these words: I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above, or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work. Honor your father and your mother, so that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male, or female slave, or ox, or donkey, or anything that belongs to the neighbor. When all the people witnessed the thunder and lightning, the sound of the trumpet, and the mountain smoking, they were afraid and trembled and stood at a distance and said to Moses, "You speak to us, and we will listen, but do not let God speak to us, or we will die." Moses said to the people, "Do not be afraid, for God has come only to test you, and to put the fear of him upon you, so that you do not sin." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please remain seated as I recite for you Psalm number 19. Psalm 19. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament shows his handiwork. One day tells its tale to another, and one night imparts knowledge to another. Although they have no words or language, and their voices are not heard, their sound has gone out into all lands, and their message to the ends of the world. In the deep has he set a pavilion for the sun. It comes forth like a bridegroom out of his chamber. It rejoices like a champion to run its course. It goes forth from the uttermost edge of the heavens and runs about to the end of it again. Nothing is hidden from its burning heat. The law of the Lord is perfect and revives the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure and gives wisdom to the innocent. The statutes of the Lord are just and rejoice the heart. The commandment of the Lord is clear and gives light to the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean and endures forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, more than much fine gold, sweeter far than honey in the comb. By them also is your servant enlightened, and in keeping them there is great reward. Who can tell how often he offends? Cleanse me from my secret faults. Above all, keep your servant from presumptuous sins. Let them not get dominion over me. Then shall I be whole and sound and innocent of a great offense. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my Redeemer. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Please remain seated for the second reading.
A reading from the book of the Philippians, chapter 3, verses 4b to 14. If anyone has reason to be confident in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day, a member of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew born of Hebrews. As to the law, a Pharisee. As to zeal, a persecutor of the church. As to righteousness under the law, blameless. Yet whatever gain I have, these I have come to regard as loss because of Christ. More than that, I have regarded everything as loss because of the surpassing values of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake I have suffered the loss of all things, and I regard them as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him. Not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but one that comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God based on faith. I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the sharing of his sufferings by becoming like him in his death, if somehow I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained this or have already reached this goal, but I press on to make it my own, because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Beloved, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but this one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead. I press on towards the goal of the prize of the heavenly call of God in Christ Jesus. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Lord be with you. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Matthew chapter 21, reading from verse 33 to 46. Jesus said, "Listen to another parable. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard, put a fence around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a watchtower. Then he leased it to tenants and went to another country. When the harvest time had come, he sent his slaves to the tenants to collect his produce. But the tenants seized his slaves and beat one, killed another, and stoned another. Again, he sent other slaves, more than the first, and they treated them in the same way. Finally, he sent his son to them, saying, 'They will respect my son.' But when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, 'This is the heir. Come, let us kill him and get his inheritance.' So they seized him, threw him out of the vineyard, and killed him. Now when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants?" They said to him, "He will put those wretches to a miserable death and lease the vineyard to other tenants who will give him the produce at the harvest time. Jesus said to them, "Have you never read in the scriptures? The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Therefore, I tell you, the kingdom of heaven will be taken away from you and given to a people that produces the fruit of the kingdom. The one who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces, and it will crush anyone on whom it falls." When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard his parables, they realized that he was speaking about them. They wanted to arrest him, but they feared the crowds because they regarded him as a prophet. This is the gospel of Christ. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Good morning, everyone. Let us take a moment now as we bow our heads in prayer. Gracious and living God, we pause once again just to give you thanks for having brought us in safety to this new day. Lord, we thank you for your grace and your mercy and your presence, Lord, that is always with us. Right now, O God, your word upon our hearts, change and transform our lives, that by your help, O God, we may produce the fruit in our lives that you expect of us. May I speak to you in the name of the God who is Father and Son and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Friends, it is good to see all of you today. One quick thing before I begin. So, because there are so few of us, we'll need a little bit of help, all right? So, in terms of the responses. So, please don't make Father Theodore do a solo today, all right? But that said, I am very happy to see all of you today. It is still a pleasure. There's nothing that quite compares to corporate worship, I think. And so, we give God thanks, as I've said, for the ability to gather in this way, even though we must do so under these present restrictions. I want to share with you, friends, some words from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 21 and verse 38. There Jesus says, "But when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, 'This is the heir. Come, let us kill him and get his inheritance.'" As I thought about today's scripture reading, it occurred to me that, you know, there is nothing quite like feeling secure where you are in life, wherever that might be, and then all of a sudden having the rug pulled from out underneath you, as it were. And since, of course, the beginning of this coronavirus pandemic, countries around the world, nations and peoples, everyone has had precisely this sort of firsthand experience of what it means to have that rug pulled out from underneath you. At one moment, your health, your jobs, your economies, your lives were relatively secure, at least for some people. And then all of a sudden, that is within the space of about 9 months or so, we have found ourselves now confronted by the reality that according to Johns Hopkins University, over 1 million people globally have now died due to the coronavirus. The rug has been pulled out from beneath us as we know it, as a society. And we have now been left to grapple, I believe, with the question of how now do we begin to negotiate our world? How do we begin to move around in our world when all of our familiar and all of our comfortable ways of relating to one another have been turned upside down? The Jesus whom we meet in today's gospel reading is not the meek and mild Jesus that so many, particularly in Western contemporary culture, have perhaps become familiar with and comfortable with. And so following the parable of the two sons, which we heard in last Sunday's gospel reading, Jesus tells another parable today, the parable of the wicked tenants. And this parable, I believe, was one through which he essentially pulled the rug out from beneath the chief priests and the Pharisees, who in many ways had grown so comfortable, had grown so familiar in their privileged roles, in their privileged positions as receivers and as teachers of the law, so much so that they refused to let anyone, and ironically not even God incarnate, to come and to cause trouble or to spoil their plans. You see, in the law of Moses, God had given and provided the Israelites all that they needed to flourish in their relationship with him and in their relationship with one another, right? That's what it means that he went and he dug out this place for this vineyard. He planted and put a wine press, put a hedge around it. He gave them everything that they needed in order to flourish. He had given everything so that the fruits of righteousness might begin to be produced in their lives, in order that they may begin to be a light to lighten the other nations. But yet, as they became familiar and comfortable in this role, the religious leaders began to act as though they could take what God had given them, all the laws, all the commandments, and have it in their possession as like a treasure, right? It became a source of pride with regard to their identity as being the chosen people of God. And so they held on to these laws. They held on to these commandments. They taught it meticulously. And they taught it as the ethical written code that they should do, right? This tells them how they were to live. But they held on to these things seemingly without any kind of real reflection on the kind of people that God was calling them to be and the sort of preparation that God was seeking to bring about in their hearts as they awaited their long-awaited Messiah. In other words, they seem to be more fond of the idea of being known as God's chosen people than they were with the implications of what that meant for the fruitful transformation of their hearts and minds and souls. You know, they had been waiting for a very long time for God's Messiah to be revealed. And when God finally sent the Son to be their true king and to be their true Messiah, just like the wicked tenants, they recognized who he was. It wasn't like they didn't know. They recognized who he was. They had witnessed the authority and the power on display in his earthly ministry. But they determined to kill him rather than to yield to him, to yield their lives to him in order that he might produce within their lives the fruitfulness which God desires, the fruitfulness that help us to become more like Christ. Because that's what this is all about. To make us more like Jesus. And so it is folly for us to think that we can kill the Son and take what belongs to him. That is our lives, right? These lives are not our own. It is folly for us to think that we can kill the Son, stamp him out, move him aside, rather than produce the fruit that he expects of us. And I believe that the default sort of habit of thought for so many people today is to live this life as if it is ours to do whatever we want to do with it. to live it however we wish. But let me say to you, friends, that this is not the case. And this is a very difficult habit to shake even after we become believers. We struggle with our wills. We want to live our lives according to our values and our goals and our attitudes, which have little or nothing to do with what it means to be a follower of Jesus. But of course, we all know, friends, our lives are not our own. The scriptures remind us that we were bought with a price. Jesus, through his earthly ministry, has saved us from eternal separation from this one who is the living God. And like the wicked tenant, sometimes we mistakenly think that these gifts of the gospel message and of the salvation that has been proclaimed in Jesus Christ, that these are our possessions, things that we must hold on to as some kind of treasure. Or in order to make the claim that we are children of the living God, because we have these things. And like them, we hold on and we claim these things without any real reflection on the kind of people that God is calling us to be, day in and day out. And you know, just like the wicked tenants, I feel that sometimes, you know, they beat up the son when he came, and sometimes we deliberately shut God out. We bracket God from the parts of our lives that we don't want him to touch. We bracket out his prophetic words to us in scripture and through the word proclaimed. We want God to be in our lives, but only on our terms. Let me say this to you, friends. Jesus isn't calling us to be good Anglicans. Right? We'll get a shock at the end of the age because there'll be no sort of camp for Anglicans over here and Roman Catholics over here and Pentecostals over there and right, whatever other than. He's not calling us to be good Anglicans, to come to church every Sunday, to go through the motions, to learn the services inside out and all of the words and, you know, then to offer God of our time and our talents and treasures, of course, only to the extent that it costs us something, because we don't want to give any more than that. And the unfortunate reality is that you find that you could be in church for decades and yet remain unchanged and untransformed. And in this kind of situation, Christ may indeed be someone whom we come to admire, someone whom we even come to respect, but he is certainly not Lord of our lives because we give little thought or intention to actually trying to do what he says. In our minds and in our hearts, there's always some reason or some excuse, rather, why we can't or we won't give him all of our lives. Give him these lives which belong to him, not to us. Jesus, I like what you're saying, but you know, this over here is pretty sweet too. So you just hold on a minute, let me deal with this, get this out of my life, and then, right? Whatever the case may be. And what Jesus really wants is for us to become his apprentices. For us to journey with him, to abide with him, to learn from him as we journey with him. What he wants for us to do is to welcome him into the center of our lives, in order that he may produce in our lives this fruit of our redemption, the fruit of our having been redeemed by him. But we belong to Christ, and we are intended to produce that fruit. And make no mistake about it, Jesus' parable that we hear about today, it comes with a very stark warning. Right? The work of God's kingdom, friends, is pressing on. It is moving forward. It cannot be killed, and we cannot stop it. It is folly for us to think that we can kill the Son and take what belongs to Him, that is our lives, and do what we will. It is folly for us to think that we can kill the Son, take what belongs to Him, rather than produce the fruit that He expects. Jesus rightfully expects that we should become more Christ-like as we journey with Him. But you know, the warning is that if we don't want the gospel, or if we don't want to hear the gospel message, if we don't really want Christ to be the goal of our lives, if we really don't want what Christ has to offer, if we don't really want Him to be a part of our lives in that way, then the reality is we will look up one day, friends, and discover that the community that we thought we felt secure in will no longer be there. It'll be taken away from us. And you know what? Those who do want to hear, those who do want to respond, truly respond in faith, those who do want to produce the fruits of the kingdom, will be given every opportunity to do so. That's just the way that the kingdom of God works. So when Paul had the rug pulled from underneath him, you remember on the road to Damascus, he came to regard all the gains that he had made in this life as loss for the sake of Jesus Christ. All those things he thought were important, even in terms of his obedience to the law, you remember he said he was a Pharisee of Pharisees, right? Top notch. If anyone knew the law, he knew it. All those things he came to regard as loss. Paul now had only one goal. That goal was to become more like Jesus Christ. So my prayer, friends, is that that would become our goal more and more every day. That these words that we hear, words that we read in Scripture, are not just something we do on a Sunday or something we come and listen to and we say, oh, that's nice. But that we allow God to change us and truly transform us. Paul said, this one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the heavenly call of God in Jesus Christ. May that be our goal from this day forward. Amen. Please stand, and let us now, in the words of the Apostles' Creed, confess the faith of our baptism in this God who has come among us in order to reap the fruit that He expects from us, as we say, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Friends, please kneel as you are able as we pray.
holy protector. You are the Lord our God, who brought us out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. Release your spirit afresh and anew upon your church, the gathered community of believers. In the Anglican Church of Canada, we pray especially for the bishop, clergy, and people of the Diocese of British Columbia. In the Evangelical Lutheran Church in Canada, we pray for the dean, council, and congregations of the Lower Mainland region of the British Columbia Synod. In our own Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for the Anglican Church of Tanzania and for the Most Reverend Dr. Maimbo Mdola, Archbishop of Tanzania and Bishop of Tanga. We pray that all may know that you are the Lord our God, who brought us out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. Today, we pray for the release of those held captive by cruel governments and human traffickers, by oppressive ideologies and suffocating theologies, that all may know that you are the Lord our God, who brought us out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. We pray for the release of those held captive by debilitating disease and mental illness, by crippling addiction and chronic fear. We remember and pray especially for the following members of this congregation: Alton,
Courtney,
Thelma,
Maureen,
Joe,
George,
Clifton,
Kathleen,
Ruben,
Kinnear,
Nellie. Andrew.
Carmen.
Christiana.
Rita.
Tourette.
Felicia.
Ian.
Pat.
Paul.
Ethel.
Joan.
Doreen.
Rima.
Hyacinth.
And Pauline.
Pauline.
We pray for those now on our hearts and minds, and for those who have asked the prayers of this congregation, especially Thelma Chastel, Evelyn Greenwich, and Ruth Lynn Hoyt. We pray for those whose needs are known to you and you alone. We pray that all may know that you are the Lord our God, who brought us out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. We pray for the release of those held captive by crushing grief and paralyzing memories, piercing loneliness, and deadening hopelessness, that all may know that you are the Lord our God, who brought us out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. Release your blessing afresh and anew within the lives of those whom you send to us week by week. We pray that you will send to this community of faith individuals, young families, and children. And we pray especially for all those who may be visiting with us online or in person today, that you will meet them where they are and that they may receive your blessing through this gathering. We pray that all may know that you are the Lord our God, who brought us out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. Release within us your divine compassion and care on behalf of those who suffer, that all may know that you are the Lord our God, who brought us out into the land of promise, into the house of salvation, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. He welcomes sinners and invites them to his table. Let us therefore confess our sins, confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Friends, please stand for the greeting of peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. I invite you to remain where you are and to turn and to greet your neighbors with a sign of peace. So for those who may be with us for the first time this day, as we sing our offertory hymn, I invite you to come forward if you wish to do so, guided by our ushers, in order to place your offering in the collection basket that is at the front, as we are not permitted to hand around a collection plate. But we give God thanks for all the gifts received on this day. We listen to the hymn, Standing on the Promises of God. Pray together the prayer over the offerings as we give God thanks for all of the gifts received this day for the work of ministry. Let us pray. God of truth, receive all we offer you this day. Make us worthy servants, strong to follow in the pattern of our Lord and the Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our service continues with Eucharistic prayer, Form 3. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Blessed are you, gracious God, creator of heaven and earth. You are the source of light and life for all your creation. You made us in your own image and call us to new life in Jesus Christ, our Savior. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Please kneel as you are able. We give thanks to you, Lord our God, for the goodness and love you have made known to us in creation, in calling Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, a death he freely accepted, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. When he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And after supper, he took the cup of wine. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, Father, according to his command, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we, made acceptable in him, may be sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, reconcile all things in Christ and make them new, and bring us to that city of light, where you dwell with all your sons and daughters, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation, by whom, and with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Now, as our Savior Christ hath taught us, we are bold to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. We, being many, are one body, for we all share in the one bread. The gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. As you come forward to receive communion this day, please be reminded that I invite you to stop at the first yellow line. Please be sure to sanitize. I will say to you the words of administration, after which you'll receive the wafer in your hand. Please then walk over to one of the sanitizing stations, remove your mask, place the wafer into your mouth, replace the mask, and then sanitize your hands as you return to your seats. Body of Christ given for you. Body of Christ given for you. Take this remembrance of Christ has died for you. Continue to feed on him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. Body of Christ given for you. Take this remembrance that Christ has died for you. Continue to feed on him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. Body of Christ given for you. Take this remembrance that Christ has died for you. Continue to feed on him in your heart by faith, always with thanksgiving. Body of Christ given for you. Take this remembrance that Christ has died for you. Continue to feed on him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. Body of Christ given for you. Take this in remembrance that Christ has died for you. Continue to feed on him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. Body of Christ given for you. Take this in remembrance that Christ has died for you. Continue to feed on him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. Body of Christ given for you. Take this in remembrance that Christ has died for you. Continue to feed on him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. Body of Christ given for you. Take this in remembrance that Christ has died for you. Continue to feed on him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. Body of Christ given for you. Take this remembrance that Christ has died for you. Continue to feed on him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. Body of Christ given for you. Take this remembrance that Christ has died for you. Continue to feed on him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. Body body of Christ given for you. Body of Christ given for you, Talise. Take this remembrance that Christ has died for you. Continue to feed on him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. Time, if there is anyone who would wish to come forward for prayers, for birthdays or anniversaries or any other special occasion or need, I'd be delighted to pray with you at this time. All right. Friends, please stand as we together give God thanks in the words of our prayer after communion for all of the gifts received and offered in this Eucharistic gathering. Let us pray. We say together, Almighty God, may we who have been strengthened by this Eucharist remain in your steadfast love and show in our lives the saving mystery that we celebrate. This we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, the Lord. Amen. We say together, glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to generation, in the church and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you this day and forevermore. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. Good morning, everyone. How are we today? We're doing well. All right. You know, it's a bit hard sometimes to figure out who folks are behind the mask. I'm glad I know what your eyes and the top of your heads look like. But it is good to see all of you today. And again, I welcome you to this service. So as we continue on, as I've been saying over the past few weeks, I know that these new protocols they may seem like a bit much, but even from what I'm observing, I can tell that we are beginning to get the hang of what these look like now in the context of the Eucharist. We've been used to washing our hands, wearing the mask, keeping our distance, sanitizing regularly, and so now we're able to continue to be a part of our corporate gathering. That said, our online offerings will continue, and so we have a service pre-recorded that is available at 10:30 a.m. Each Sunday morning. Morning prayer continues Monday through Friday at 7:30. I said to the congregation this morning that if you are up at 7:30, and then I changed it, I said, no, set your alarm for 7:30 if you are not up so that you can join us. This is a delightful little gathering that we have, just an opportunity for us to gather as a community, even virtually, as we pray for one another and as we pray for the day. So if you are available, I encourage you to sign up and to click on. All the connection details are there on our website. Please also note that our Bible study in Philippians continues this week, Thursday at 7 p.m. Again, if you are interested, the connection details are the same as morning prayer. So if you go onto our website, you will see the connection details there. We are about halfway through, but it's still not too late to be a part of that study. And so I encourage you to join us on Thursday evening at 7 for about an hour and a half. Again, one more way of feeding ourselves spiritually and developing those fruit that we are called to produce by God's help. Please also note that this coming Wednesday, our Saints Cafe, which has been operating now in partnership with Black Creek Community Health Center, will launch the takeout component of our program. And so beginning this Wednesday between 3:30 to 4:30, all of our friends from the community who would normally come for a prepared sit-down meal will now have the opportunity to come and to get a takeout at curbside. So if you know of anyone for whom this may be of help, please do let them know. I know we have a number of people who are already interested in coming, and I've put the word out as well through my own networks, and so I encourage you to let folks know about this. Of course, we continue to remember also all of our young people, our young adults, as they have returned to school, colleges, universities. I know a lot of parents are still anxious, and everyone's watching to see what the trend will be as we approach mid-October and then later into the month. But we continue to pray for all of them, for their health, for their safety, above all, for their education, and that is not compromised along the way. That said, we are grateful for the donation of backpacks that we've received. A number of them have now gone. We still have a few remaining, and so if you know of any young persons who still need school supplies or a backpack, again, please let us know. We'd be happy to provide those for them. On the 16th of October at 8 p.m., the Diocese of Toronto will be hosting its Bishop's Company Cabaret. So this takes the place of the annual Bishop's Company dinner that's usually held within the diocese. And this is a fundraiser primarily in support of the urgent need that arises among clergy or other circumstances within the diocese when that help in sort of, you know, hard, tangible ways is needed in a very quick or short space of time. Because we cannot gather corporately, this is now a virtual offering. And so if you are interested in being a part of that, again, I encourage you to visit our parish's website, where you will find the information where you can register and get a link. There is no cost to attending, but you are welcomed and invited to make a donation. There will be entertainment from across the diocese on that night, and also a virtual address by Archbishop Linda Nichols. Some of you will remember Linda Nichols during her time here in Toronto. And so she will be bringing an address on that night, along with a testimony which will also be offered on that evening. So I encourage you on that evening, the 16th of October at 8 p.m., to support the Bishop's Company Cabaret. On a sad note, we want to remember in our prayers Irene Garnett. Just yesterday, she was, along with her family, able to bid farewell to her brother Harold, who passed away earlier in the year. During these times of COVID, making these sorts of arrangements has been a bit of a challenge. And so she and her family were able to bid farewell to her brother just yesterday afternoon. So we continue to remember Irene. Irene is normally here at 11 o'clock. She was very happy when we started gathering again corporately. And so she's not here today, and presumably it has to do with events of yesterday. On a happier note, we extend our congratulations to Kalisha Linton and to Ryan Blair, who were married from this sanctuary yesterday afternoon. Kalisha is the daughter of Iris, our envelope secretary, and so it was a great afternoon, small gathering, but intimate family and friends, and we are thankful for the flowers that remain behind following the service, but we wish Kalisha and Ryan every good gift and blessing from above as they move forward in their life together in this community. There are a couple of birthdays being celebrated this week. I have not been all that good in remembering the birthdays, and so I'm trying to change, all right? Today, or yesterday, let's start with yesterday, Christian Murray celebrated his birthday. Today, Arlene, Arlene marks her birthday on this day, along with Rochelle Cox, who I think is a relative of Christine. Yes, so please do remember them in your prayers for today. Tomorrow, Ikena is celebrating his birthday. He was here at the 9 o'clock service. He is a regular at the 9 o'clock, and so we pray for him as he prepares to celebrate tomorrow. And also on Tuesday, Aluko Key and Daisy Wilkes will celebrate their birthdays. And so we continue to remember all of them in prayer this week as they mark another year of life. Friends, please stand. We listen to our recessional hymn, All Creatures of Our God and King. I invite you to hum along. We cannot sing, but I invite you to hum along and to sway along and to listen to the words in your hearts. As I've said in past weeks, one of the benefits of singing these hymns over the years is that the words are now written in our hearts. And so even if we cannot express them vocally, we can certainly listen to them as we sing them in our hearts and as we hum. All creatures of our God and King. Thank you. in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.